Soul shot, baby! So, good day, everyone. We're here for another episode of the DVD show. So, for today, we have the gold medalist from the 2019 SEA Games, and she was also a gold medalist in the 2017 SEA Games and third place in 2018 Asian Games. I'll now welcome Miss Agatha Wong. Thank you for joining me here on the DVD show.
Hi guys. Hi Gay. Hi Diego. Yeah. Thank you so much for having me here today. And I'm really grateful for the opportunity that you asked me to do.
Yeah, okay. Thank you so much again. And so to start things off, before we talk about your career in wushu, I wanted to ask, how are you now, especially because it's MECQ and we're all stuck at our houses. How have you been doing naman and coping up with the pandemic? It's been more than a year already.
Right now kasi I've just been trying to study for some exams na I'm planning to apply in some universities kasi I wanna study pa. So I don't know what further studies na I want. So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm just preparing for some exams and some requirements. Tapos I still train, pero syempre it's not as intense as before pre-pandemic. So I'm just trying to figure out yung balance between the two.
Okay. What did you finish in your undergraduate studies? Like, what do you want to pursue before master's or doctorate?
So I graduated with a Bachelor of Arts major in Consular and Diplomatic Affairs sa BNILD. Tapos I graduated in 2018, and then after that, I took 2019 off to prepare for SEA Games. And then 2020 happened. Tapos nagka-pandemic, and then everyone kept telling me not to study yet. Kasi it's really hard though with online class. Pero now, kasi I kind of knew na this 2021, it's not getting any better. So naisip, it's okay. I'll just start studying na siguro, and then I'll just think of where it would lead me. So right now, I'm thinking of taking up law.
Okay.
Yun. So yun naman so far.
Do you plan to take it here or like abroad?
No, I can't go abroad because I have sports pa here, and I really want to continue it. So I'm taking it here locally.
Okay. So you also mentioned your training, like it's not as intense as pre-pandemic. So how do you train? Yeah. Like your sports it's also kind of hard to find to train like now in the middle of a pandemic. So how do you do it naman? How do you manage?
Well, thankfully, I have my coach to keep me, to remind me that I have to keep training. Because it's really, like you said before, before we started recording, it's really hard to wake up next to, sometimes kasi when I wake up, yung floor namin sa room, that's where I exercise. So, minsan it's hard to, fight the urge to just stay in bed. Pero so yung ginagawa ko is sometimes I exercise outside the house, like dyan lang sa kalsada, or sometimes I exercise in the garage.
Yeah.
So it keeps me from not getting too lazy. So yun yung ginagawa ko.
Okay, that's good daw because it's really tough for athletes now. Like pero yung mga iba like kumare first 2 months nung pandemic medyo nahirapan, pero after a while they started going back to their like normal life, so it's really tough.
So
here in this pandemic, did you get into some new hobbies or new quarantine activities that you continue doing even if it's been 1 year already?
Nung beginning ng pandemic, me and Jamie Lim, I don't know if your audience or you knows her, pero she's the gold medalist for karate. So we collaborated before to start a fundraiser. Tapos, she told me after we finished that na she wanted to start another one, but this time for the elections. Tapos, since we're busy, she's busy with Olympic training, tapos I'm busy with my own share of responsibilities as a national athlete. We decided to stop it first, and then I think we're gonna continue it maybe later this year until 2022. So stay tuned for that. I'm not yet sure how it will work. Pero kasi ngayon, we're still doing our own share of responsibilities as an athlete. Yun. Tapos I recently started cooking. Being an athlete kasi pre-pandemic, I wasn't always at home. So yung ginagawa ko lang is training, eating, and just resting. So now I'm starting to spend more time with my family and starting to cook and starting to find just new little things to find every day.
Yeah, Jamie also, I invited her to join the podcast, but she said after her training in Turkey, because it's kind of hard with the training and the time difference. But she said she's G also, so I'll invite her because it's a good conversation also.
Yeah, that would be really great.
Yeah. So for the future competitions of Wushu, do you have anything that the people could look forward to, or wala muna kasi nga pandemic, so you just train individually?
Actually, kaka-meeting lang namin ng team ko, I think 2 weeks ago. Tapos yung sabi ng head coach namin is, yung International Wushu Federation, they're planning to take the first online competition. I think it will be held in June, anywhere between June or to August. Tapos sabi niya sa amin, we have to keep training, we have to keep being consistent kasi only 6 athletes will get picked from the team. Tapos kami in the team, we're like 30 to 40. So, I'm not sure how my other teammates feel, if they really want to compete. Syempre, we're not in the same conditions we were before SEA Games.
Yeah.
So, we're going to see who qualifies for the competition. And then after the online competition, we have SEA Games, which we're still not sure if we're going to push through with it.
Ah, okay, okay. So yeah, those are stuff to look forward to. Kasi syempre for now nga, parang wala namang masyadong nangyayari since the SEA Games 2019 with Wushu. Yeah. It's really tough for you guys.
It is.
Yeah. So with this, with your success so far, people know already of like the gold medals you've been achieving. But it's also good to look back on like your childhood and how you grew up with the sport and how you became successful with Wushu ever since at a young age. So to start things off, I wanted to ask, how was your childhood like? Like, did you like Wushu initially, or did you have other activities you did before you went to Wushu?
So I engaged in a multitude of sports before when I was a kid. So ang dami kong ginawang sports, like I did swimming, I did ballet, I did karate, and then I did wushu. I also did ice skating. Tapos out of that 5 sports, when I turned 12 or 13, I chose wushu. Kasi yung mga ibang sports, hindi ko na siya magagawa. For example, ice skating. I have to be beside a mall kasi that's where they train, right? Like ice hockey, ice skating, speed skating, lahat dun sa mall yun. And then ballet, I wasn't that girly before. So I decided to stop that. And then karate, we had like some problems with the club, so we stopped that as well. And then what was left was swimming and then wushu. Yung nangyari sa swimming ko is my passion died. I don't know why, but I think it just happens talaga to the best of us. It just dies. And then I started focusing on wushu more. And then I fell in love with the sport as I became more consistent with training.
Yeah. Okay, so how do you think you fell in love with it, even if it's, you know, not really a known sport here in the Philippines at least? And syempre, like here, it's like mga volleyball or football or I don't know, like, like swimming or what else? I don't know, like the other sports that girls normally play. Like it's not really the traditional sport. So how do you think you loved it? And it's like, even if it's like pretty unique.
I think what really caught my eye in wushu was how hard it was for a girl. Before kasi, up until now, most of my teammates are guys, and I don't really pay mind to that kasi what matters to me is how it makes me feel, how doing wushu makes me feel. It makes me feel very invigorated and it makes me feel excited and scared every time I compete. Tapos sa wushu kasi wala kaming mga levels, so when you reach a certain age, which is 18, you can compete na in like the top competition. So kahit na ano yung level mo, you can compete na. Pero kasi yung catch dun is you can't run out of forms or kumbaga like categories to learn. So for example, right now, like ang daming lumalabas na bagong traditional forms, like there's the drunken sword, drunken fist, there's the chain whip. Ang dami mong pwedeng matutunan even if you're a professional wushu athlete. So that's the one thing that I really like sa wushu. It made me fell in love kasi hindi ka mauubusan ng papag-aralan. And I like learning every day. And I like, I guess I like giving myself a hard time there in every day. So I think
yeah.
that's what, I think that's, me and wushu are like a perfect combo. Like, yeah.
Yeah, for some of the viewers, maybe they're not really familiar with the sport. And me personally, I just saw it before, like on TV. I don't really watch it. And then, syempre, before this interview, I prepared and then I checked like in YouTube, like your future, your competitions before and what your how you do it. So, syempre, it's really tough nga. Parang sabi ko, wow, ang hirap pala nun. Parang feeling walang nangyayari. Pero it's really tough.
Yeah, it is. Honestly, up until now, even after nakailang years na ba ako, like more than 10 years na ako sa wushu, I still find it hard. I'm not gonna admit na it's easy kasi it's really hard for me, especially before a competition. Every competition naman, kahit na ano siya, kahit na Asian Championships or like Asia and traditional, lalo na SEA Games and Asian Games, it's really hard for me kasi yung nerves, kasi mag-isa ka lang nun, wushu is usually an individual sport sa category ko, which is taolu. So,
yeah.
you have to be by yourself, tapos no one's gonna help you if you have a mistake. So, you're really your own sole responsibility.
Yeah. Before pala we continue, I wanted to ask lang if you could like explain like the objective of wushu, like for the people that might not understand. Like kunwari, ano yung, yeah, what's the objective? Like how do you win the gold medal? And maybe ano yung mga hurdles like during the competition na nahihirapan ka pero na overcome pa din. Yung mga ganun basic concepts lang para lang they get it or something.
Yeah, sure. So yeah. So what from what we know kasi, compared to other martial arts, karate is from Japan, taekwondo is from Korea. So wushu naturally came from China.
Yeah.
So in wushu, there's always two categories. Sa martial arts, may dalawang category. Diba? Sa taekwondo, there's pumse, and then there's the other category. I forgot. Yeah. Sa karate naman, there's kata, and then the other one that I also
yeah.
forgot.
Yeah.
In wushu, there's taolu, and then there's sanda. So sanda is the sparring part of the martial art, and then taolu is the performance base of the martial art. So in sanda, bawat suntok sipa may puntos.
Oh.
So ganun lang, it's like boxing. So bawat punch, you throw a kick, there's one or two points. So it's basically easy naman to understand. So in sanda, it's really safe kasi you have a headgear, you have gloves, you have a body gear.
Mm-hmm.
You also have shin guards. So that's really safe lang for us as wushu athletes. And then sa taolu, honestly sa taolu, it's much more difficult kasi yung body, yung physical qualifications for each person, it's very different. So sa sanda, you have to be buff, you have to be stiff, but you also have to be kind of flexible. So wushu, sa taolu, it's very different. You have to be flexible, you have to have power. Tapos kailangan very developed yung muscles mo early on as a child. Kasi if you develop them late na, hindi na magka-catch up yung flexibility mo. So
okay.
Sa taolu there are three categories, main categories. So each person or each child when they start wushu, they always enter the first category, which is changchun. So that means long fist. So sa changchun there are five categories. So changchun meaning bare hands, merong staff, merong spear, merong straight sword, merong broad sword. So the coach decides which person branches out to which category. And the second one, pagkatapos ng tao dun sa changchun, pag feeling ng coach, medyo masyado siyang powerful, masyado siyang, the person's kind of short, he or she transfers the person to nanchun, which is yung may mga tumbling, tapos yung may mga sigaw. So makikita mo yun sa wushu, pag may sigaw ng tao, that means, nanchun. And then, when the coach feels that the person is more meek, tapos very flexible, very soft yung movements, he branches the person out to tai chi chuan. So that's my category, tai chi chuan. Sa tai chi naman, it's more of soft movement. Tapos yung mga jumps namin, we jump and then land on one foot. So for each category, there's their own difficulty. So sa tai chi, there's only the straight sword and then the bare hands. Sa nanchuan, there's the broadsword and also the kajil. And then sa changchuan, it's either spear ka or straight sword or broadsword ka and kajil. So medyo mahirap siyang intindihin right now kasi I don't have like the
yeah.
parang the branch of it.
Yeah.
But yun yung epitome of wushu.
Yeah. So yung sa category mo specifically, like kung saan ka nanalo ng gold, like yung pinaka-recent na SEA Games. So yung coach mo lang yung nag-assign like based on your strength and your physique, ano?
Yeah, so ano, the coach bases what category you would put into when you're young pa. So for example, when you turn 21, you can't transfer to another category kasi iba na talaga eh. Like pag na-determine ako ano yung kung saan ka mas best fitted for, dun ka na magsistay. You can still learn from Changchun, for example, Nanchun ka, you can still learn from Changchun or Tai Chi, pero hindi ka makaka-compete dun kasi it's not your specialty. So the coach knows best. So when I was, I started Wushu 2008, and then 2012, they decided to put me in Tai Chi Chuan. So dun ako talaga nag-stay sa Tai Chi Chuan.
So kamusta naman yung journey mo? Like, syempre, merong madaming challenges and sacrifice na you had in pursuing Wushu at a young age. You said that like 12 or like even younger. So, ano yung mga major challenges and sacrifices na pinagdaanan mo during that time that, you know, eventually it reaped rewards and it helped in your breakthrough in the sport?
I think yung mga challenges lang is really, firstly, that my sport isn't that widely recognized in the Philippines. So, every time people will ask me, oh, athlete ka pala, ano yung sport mo? So, I tell them my sport and they always ask me, ano yun? Or sometimes they make fun of it. So, I think that's one of the downsides of being engaged in a sport that's not really, yung hindi masyadong alam ng tao or as compared to volleyball or basketball. Yun yung first siguro na challenge for me. Kasi it's really hard to engage in a sport which people don't know of. Tapos, when they see you compete, they always ask you, so we don't understand what happens in competition. How did you rank? Ganun. So yun. And then the second challenge is, so in the Philippines, yung national team namin in Wushu, it's mostly composed of guys. So being a girl, it's really hard for me to kind of like see the other guys do a program that's tailored for them. Tapos sometimes the coach gives me another program, which I feel weak. Yun yung parang yun yung parang napupunta sa utak ko. Which shouldn't be the case kasi boys and girls, they're very different talaga. They have different capabilities and they have different physicalities. So that's the second challenge. And then the third challenge is generally balancing my education and also my sport. So yun yung main takeaway dun when I was growing up. Not a lot of people knew it. Tapos it was mostly male-dominated. And also yung challenge of balancing education, being with my family, time for myself, and also the sport.
Yeah. You mentioned nga na parang yung sport hindi ganun kasikat and it's composed of mostly guys. And you mentioned in an article before na parang you didn't want to be really known as an athlete pa yun nung mas bata ka. Like when you're walking around, parang you want to be like a normal person, quote-unquote lang. Ayaw mo na parang you're like different from them. So ano naman yung kwento dun? Like, why did you want to be like normal lang ganun?
Actually, when I said that, I meant na actually, whenever I would go out, I don't really tell people what I do. So I just let the conversation, whenever I'm engaging with other people, I just let the conversation steer from me to the person. So I think it generates from my being shy and my being meek kasi I grew up as a shy and meek person talaga. And then when I graduated college, buti na lang I took my course kasi yung course ko, it really pushes you to bring out yung parang yung verbal capabilities mo. So before, I couldn't answer any interview questions. I wasn't comfortable. And then now, buti na lang I took my course kasi it made me more proficient in answering interviews and in just being myself in front of the camera.
Okay. So how about naman yung other part, yung sa education? Kasi syempre, lalo na pag mas bata, like hindi ka pa like, kumari, like below 18, medyo hindi pa mature and like you wanna just, focus on your sport and continue your success there. Pero paano naman yung pag-prioritize mo with education? Like, was it on your own or did people help you and like focusing on it?
I think, syempre, you always have to have a solid support system. So I have my parents to thank for that. Though when I was studying, hindi naman ako nag-tutor or anything. I just Well, I just coped up with schoolwork. I wasn't in the honor roll, and I wasn't a bad student. I think I was just an average student. And I think, ano lang siya, I think that was enough na for me, considering when I was in high school, I would always travel from QC to Manila to train every day. So parang if I consider the circumstances, I was doing pretty okay naman. Especially in college, mas wala na ano ako na nagulat ako dun sa environment when I entered college, kasi it's really different from high school. Like,
yeah, for sure.
You're like you're by yourself, tapos yeah, you have to figure out which people na you mesh well with, yung ganun. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Tapos in college kasi it gave me quite a difficult time, kasi whenever I would get asked, like, tara, like, ano yun, happy tea tayo, ganun. Kasi di ba sa TAF, yeah, happy tea yung yeah, parang ano natin, yeah, tradition. I couldn't go kasi I always had training after class. I had training before class in the morning. So yun yung isa sa mga sacrifices ko as a college student. I sacrificed most of my social life. Pero in the end, when I graduated on time naman, I graduated on time.
Mm-hmm.
I realized na you can always make up for the things you missed, and I did naman.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Kasi now, syempre, mas, I mean, you know, it's just like time management and putting your effort in the stuff you want to do. So, kumari, you wanna hang out with your friends, mabibigyan mo naman sila ng oras kahit yun nagte-training ka, parang ganun.
Definitely, definitely. Yeah.
So, nung, anong moment naman yung time na you knew you could succeed in the sport? Like, more of like a breakthrough moment. Like, I don't know, anong year or anong tournament yun. Like, you knew you could succeed and pursue it as like your career or like a passion in it.
I didn't really have that kind of realization. I just knew that I liked it. Tapos, I'm not sure if your audience or you knows this, pero no, when I was starting out, the first 3 years of my career as an athlete, I was always in the bottom. Like, lagi akong last place.
I read about it.
Yeah, kahit nung 2015 SEA Games, I was always in last place. Pero I don't know why I didn't stop. I just really like the sport. Tapos, I really set no expectations for myself. Lalo na nung when I first won the 2017 SEA Games, I didn't expect to win talaga. I just knew na I just wanted to be maybe top 5, top 4. And then, I didn't realize na I had that kind of potential in me. And then I thought na it was just a one-time thing. So 2017, nanalo ako ng silver and gold. Pagdating ng 2018 sa Asian Games, since Asian Games happens only once every 4 years, I wasn't really, I didn't really have any expectations talaga. And I got injured that year.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was entering Asian Games, I was just thinking na I'm thankful for the opportunity to even qualify for the games. And then I came out of it, I had a bronze. And parang, wala, I just realized na I think I didn't really know na I was that good. I just knew na I loved the sport. And then 2019 came, I still didn't have any expectations. Even though everyone thought I was gonna win, I really didn't think so. So every time I compete, I just have the mindset na I'm just gonna do my best. Yun lang talaga siya. So every time I get interviews before a competition, they always ask me, what do you think you're gonna get? I always tell them na I'm just gonna do my best. Kasi it's true naman. I can't really tell what the outcome will be. Pero just know I always do my best.
Yeah. You mentioned nga that you were last place for like a lot of your former like competitions. And it was really tough. Like for an athlete, it's tough to accept na parang last place ka palagi. And parang it reaches your mind na you wanna try something else na lang. And baka mas magaling ka pa doon. So for you, is it more of like the love for the sport or your support system that made you keep going even if, you know, last place, it's really tough, parang ano pa ba, saan pa ba ako pupunta, parang ganun. So
yeah,
paano ka naman like nagpatuloy pa rin sa wushu, and you know, it reaped its rewards eventually?
I think if, like, theoretically speaking, if for example it wasn't 3 years, let's say 5 years, I would still be in the sport. I don't know, kasi it's just how it makes me feel. Like when I jump, like dun sa training venue kasi namin, sa wushu, sa taulu, you need a high ceiling, tapos wide space, tapos may carpet. Dun ka mag-jump, dun ka mag-kick. Every time I jump, I just feel like I'm flying, and I feel really, wala, it's just this high energy na I feel in wushu. Like, being a wushu athlete, I can delve into a lot of sports. Like, for example, diba, like, whenever my one time, like, PE kami sa college, I was doing basketball. And I like, I could run faster than the other people. I could, like, dribble the ball. Like pag may magbabato ng bola, like, I could catch it. It's because of the muscle development that you catch early on in wushu. And I think it just really made me, for me, it really made me strong. And it really made me think na I can do anything. So, parang, hindi nung ano when the first 3 years of a wushu, like of my being a wushu athlete, hindi ko iniisip na kailangan manalo na ako next year. Hindi ko yun iniisip. Yung iniisip ko lang is I still want to do it. I don't know why, even though I am always last place, but I still want to do it. So I kept doing it. Yun.
So moving on to the 2017 SEA Games nga that you mentioned, may binago ka ba sa like practice routine mo or like your habits, or Did your coach change something kaya nag-breakthrough ka and you won the gold? Or same routine, tapos talagang nahasa ka lang and you were able to finally get your niche there in the sport?
I think yung na-develop sa akin was yung sense of ano ko, yung sense of consciousness ko. Before kasi, I would always be scared. Pero I was still scared ng 2017 SEA Games, pero naisip ko, no one was really expecting me to win kasi it was my second SEA Games. The first SEA Games I had was last place. So, everyone was thinking na, okay, maybe she would be top 5 or top 6. Tapos yung naisip ko is, I'm gonna give it a shot. Like, I'll just do my best. Like, whatever happens, happens. Basta, I trained for this. I didn't really cheat sa training. I didn't take any shortcuts, kumbaga. So I knew na basta kung ano yung maibibigay ko for the Philippines, that's what I'm gonna do. And then I think the first medal I got was the silver one, and then that took me by surprise kasi yung silver na yun in that category, it was my first parang senior category, and I got surprised kasi I was standing next to she was always the reigning champion. She's from Indonesia. Okay. And then the third one was Singapore. So nagulat ako, and everybody got surprised then because I didn't know na I would be top 2. I didn't know na I had the capability to be, you know, that good. And after that, I didn't think na I would get anything more because I had 2 events to compete in. And then the second event, everyone was telling me na I was like sa akin na daw yun. And my teammates kept telling me, tapos hindi po mapasok sa utak ko kasi I was so scared. Like, what if they tell me na sa'yo na yun, tapos I mess up?
Yeah.
And then I don't get it. So what was on my mind was, basta just get it over with, just finish it, just see what happens. And I won. And it was just a really, it was a really enjoyable moment for me kasi I didn't realize, you know, I didn't realize what I can be in this sport. And yeah.
So nung 2018 SEA Games naman, syempre mas mahirap na yung competition kasi mas madami ka ng kalaban, mas yung buong Asia na yung kalaban mo. So syempre masaya ka nung 2017, pero in a span of a year may new tournament ka na sasalihan. So ano naman yung mga aspects of yung wushu mo na you improved on that yun talagang you worked on for the 2018 Asian Games? Kasi syempre, it doesn't stop there from the 2017 SEA Games one.
Actually, I worked on my nerves kasi nung 2018, I got injured with my back. Tapos parang I got injured May. And then I was already training for the Asian Games. Like, I was already on, like, I was already in my top physical potential. Condition. Top physical condition. Nung ano pa lang, nung February pa lang, like, okay na ako. And then I got injured, and then I got so scared kasi it was my back. It wasn't even a part of my leg, it was my back. Where everything is stabilized, it was my back. And then, sabi ng doctor, you have to rest 2 weeks. Eh, in wushu kasi, when you rest even for one day, like, ano, parang feeling mo you'll feel weak na. Like, ganun ka grabe sa wushu. Like, if you take 2 or 3 days off, parang 100% of your potential physically ma-slash siya into 50%. So isipin mo pag 2 weeks, parang I came back to zero.
Yeah, back to square one.
My coach, he was understandable naman. He was the type of coach na pag sasabihin mo, coach, can I take 3 days off? Hindi siya papayag. Pero when he knew na it was something serious about my back. Sabi niya, okay, just don't do anything physically, don't engage in exercise for 2 weeks. Tas let's see. Tas it was May, June, July, August. 3 months na lang to Asian Games. Tapos, hindi ako mapakali. I was just bedridden. Tapos, I was just resting. Wala akong ginagawa. Like, all I could think of was the other countries, they were preparing for it. They were training for it. They're probably nagpapakahirap na sila siguro by this moment. And then, I was just at home and I was resting. So, pagbalik ko sa training, I gusto ko humataw na kagad. Pero, everyone kept telling me, Agatha, just chill. Like, just relax muna. Kasi kakagaling mo lang sa injury. We don't want you to get injured again. So, yun. I treaded up until Asian Games very, very slowly. Sobrang painfully slow for me. Pagdating ng Asian Games, I was so scared. Kasi everyone was so good. Tapos, I was injured pa. Tapos, naisip ko. Yung mentality ko nun was that don't let them know na you're injured. Kasi I think it would serve us like even more reason for them to do their best. So hindi ko sinabi kahit kanina na I was injured. Uh-oh. And then after my first event, yung event ko kasi na yun, it's combined. So when they combine two events, isa lang yung medal. So nung first ko, I think I was fifth yung first event. Tapos parang tatlo ata yung athletes na same kami ng score. So I was the first one up. Tapos so that means I was the fifth. So there were two other athletes that were the same score as me. So in order for me to be in the top three, I needed to get like maybe the same, either ano, a higher score or the same score that I got. Tapos parang, iniisip ko lang parang, hindi, okay na ako sa top five kasi it was good na, like, okay na ako.
Asian Games and, na.
Parang yeah, Asian Games eh. Like, I was so thankful. Tapos my second event came, and then I remember the night before I was gonna compete, like I was sleeping, hindi ako makatulog, and then I had the nightmare pa na something bad happened, so I couldn't sleep, and then I woke up really early. Tapos ano, I was more calm na by this time kasi in my first event I did good, so in my second event okay lang kahit na I did okay. And then yun, nag-flash yung score ko, it was the same score I had. So, inintay na lang nung coach ko and my teammates if yung two others that had the same score as me either ranked higher or lower. So, both of them, they ranked lower. So, I got into the top three. And then, nagulat ako kasi I think I was the second Filipino athlete to bag the medal or third.
Aww.
So, yeah, na individual. Kasi yung the other medals, they were group events.
Oh, okay.
So, yun. Yeah, they were group events. That's why medyo nag-boom yung sport ko kasi I was the first individual sport that bagged the medal. So, yun. I was surprised kasi I didn't know na I could do that even when I had a bad injury. So, parang dun nila nalaman na I was injured. Dun na lumabas yung info na I was injured after I won the bronze.
Okay.
Yeah, so everyone knew na. Everyone, like Singapore, Vietnam, Japan, they all knew na. So, I think that paved the way for my name, I think, na parang I was the one who got injured but still won. Parang gano'n. Which is really funny. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great story kasi syempre, kunwari, like, yung mga ibang athletes, like, they barely got injured nga or felt, like, discomfort like you, tapos hirap na hirap sila, tapos ikaw, syempre, nahirapan pa ng mas malala, and then you still bag the bronze. So, syempre, for them, parang that's impressive. How did you do that? Like, I want to be like,
I don't know. Yeah. Honestly.
Parang ganun, di ba? It's really tough to have an injury in the back. Like, I know I'm not that familiar with wushu, but like with the sports, I'm familiar with like a back injury. It can affect you in any sport talaga. And it's impressive on how you still succeeded in the tournament.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So nung moving on to the 2019 SEA Games, and yung sinasabi mo nga na that's where you made a name for yourself the year before. Was there more pressure for you, or especially it was here in the Philippines, or talagang parang you were just calm and composed with the competition?
Yeah, there was more pressure from me. Doon na nag-grow yung pressure after Asian Games. Kasi doon sa top 3 standing in Asian Games, the first one was a SEA Games country, yung Indonesia, the same girl that won in 2017. Yeah. Pero kasi yung catch doon, she retired na when she won in Asian Games.
Oh.
The second, yeah, so the second place was Hong Kong, which wasn't a SEA country. And then the third one was me. So meaning, wala na yung first, wala na yung second. So, meaning everyone was gunning for Mina, which
yeah.
I haven't dealt with that amount of pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I've dealt with it before, siguro nung 2017, I've dealt with a little bit of pressure. Pero nung 2019, grabe yung pressure. As in, lalo na na dito siya magaganap. Like, nung January pa lang, everyone was getting interviewed. Like, they wanted to know, am I gonna win? Ganun. Lalo na nung 2 months before, sabi ng coach ko, sa sobrang daming gusto mag-interview, sabi ng coach ko, bawal na mag-interview kasi it will mess with my head. So that's what we did. Hindi na ako nag-interview. Tapos, wala. Hindi na ako nag-interview. And then, I went to China for 4 months noong 2019. And then I returned September. And then I went back to China noong October to play for the World Championships. So sabi ng coach namin, sa World Championships, based on your ranking, doon nila ibe-base yung SEA Games level mo. And then, yung isang event ko, I got top 5. So, doon sa 5 na yun, first is China, hindi siya SEA Games country. Second is Japan, hindi siya SEA Games country. Pero yung third and fourth, Singapore and Vietnam, they ranked higher than me, and then I was 5th. So, I got concerned. Kasi yun yung sabi ng coach ko, like, based on the world rankings, they're gonna base it sa SEA Games. And then after the World Championship, sabi ng coach, it's okay, don't think about Singapore and Vietnam na. Like, wag mo na silang isipin kasi all that matters is SEA Games. Tapos you can still improve. So that's what we did. Tapos wala, it wasn't only me kasi everyone was having nerves na. They, like, nagkakamali na sila more often kasi nga yung pressure. Tapos minsan, tinatapon na nila yung weapons nila because, you know, we were so close to giving up kasi nga yung pressure. And then, everyone kept expecting na kailangan perfect, kailangan walang mistakes, ganon. So, wala, you could see na siguro the energy as a team that we gave, parang it wasn't really a good energy. Tapos I tried to steer away from that. Pero kasi hindi mo talaga maiiwasan since they're your teammates. And I was part of that process. So, I think the day of my first event, I was so unlucky because I got my period. Tapos, I think for guys who don't know this, when girls get their period on their first day, they have cramps. Tapos, they don't feel good. They feel queasy. They feel like vomiting. So, parang that was the first sign, I guess, na I took na parang, oh my gosh, this is gonna be a bad day. Tapos, tas bugbog na yung knee ko kasi I was training, I've been training a lot. And then my back then, it was sore. Tapos pagdating ko sa arena, lalaki yung coach ko. So I had to tell him, sabi ko, coach, I had my period. So, tapos sabi niya sa akin, it's okay, just get this over with. Tapusin mo na, and then you can rest for the entire duration of the day. So, inisip ko na lang, I couldn't take medication to help with the menstrual cramps kasi may drug test. So, tiniis ko siya. Yeah, tiniis ko siya. And then, inisip ko na lang na parang, it's okay, I can rest after this. It's okay, it's okay. So, parang, we were all scared. I was scared kasi I was the first event. And then, I think I was the first one up. No. Yeah, the first one up ata or the fifth one. Either that. Tapos, it was my first time to go in the arena and then hear, like, the crowd. They were really noisy and they were noisy for me.
Yeah.
That was, I got really nervous, honestly. I think that was the time na parang I had to block everything out. That's just think na parang, just finish this. And then after my first event, I didn't know if I was in the leading, but so they flashed my score. Tapos, after that, parang my interviews and stuff like that. And then I ran to the bleachers. And then I tried to find my parents. Tapos when I saw my dad, I started crying na. Actually, before that, paakit pa lang ako ng bleachers na ano ko pa nga, na salubong ko pa yung isang former coach ko. I was crying na. Tapos parang he said, congrats. Tapos I didn't know if I won. And then I hugged my dad, I hugged my mom. I was crying. And then my family relatives were also crying kasi I was so relieved kasi it's finally done. I didn't know if I won, I didn't know if I lost, but it was done and parang this whole pressure was lifted off my shoulders. So parang that's the reason I cried. So parang I think people associate me with the picture of me biting my metal as I was crying.
Mm, I remember.
Kasi sabi nung media, ano kagatin mo yung medal mo, kagatin mo yung medal. Yeah. I was like, okay. Yun. So yun, it was a really memorable thing. Kasi yung chairman ng PSC yung nagbigay ng medal, si William Butcher Ramirez. Yeah. And then I was umiiyak ako nun, tapos sabi niya sa akin, forgotten country. Tapos lalo lang ako umiyak kasi it's true, it's really forgotten country. So, yun.
So, yung sinasabi mo rin daw nung interview after the SEA Games na you weren't really satisfied with your performance, like you felt you could have done better. So, anong aspect ba of your, like, your performance that you felt you could have done better pa? Kasi parang you weren't that satisfied yet. And yun nga, you weren't sure if you were gonna win.
I think I'm the type of person kasi na, honestly, I'm the type of person who would be okay with being second, third, fourth, and fifth. Kasi pag first ka na, you don't really have anyone to beat na. So parang naisip ko, like, how can I be better? So inisip ko yung form ko. There, I think there were some corrections lang na I needed to polish, mga ganon. So that's why I said na I think I could have been better kasi I could have improved more on the details, which hindi naman siya masyadong noticeable sa routine. Pero syempre, as an athlete, I always want to embrace the opportunity to correct my mistakes. So that's what I did. After the SEA Games, I tried to review everyone's forms and also mine. Yun.
So nung yung sinasabi mo din nung SEA Games na what you call this na you won nga, and there were like many people na saying na there were like controversies with your win in the SEA Games. So for you naman, how did you like block off the noise and not listen to those people? Because syempre parang they're just wanting to say something with your gold medal. Pero syempre for you, you were saying that it's for the Philippines and all these things. So how did you block it off and not affect you mentally?
Before the SEA Games, wala namang naging issue. Like, everyone was just rooting for every Filipino athlete. Basta Filipino ka, we're rooting for you. Ganun lang sila. And then after the SEA Games, doon na lumitaw yung mga problems na parang, like, why do I have a Chinese surname? Tapos parang, Chinese yung sport, that's why she won. Because she's Chinese. Tapos, it was, I think I expected it na. Kasi I've had past athlete friends who also experienced the same thing. They had a different surname. Tapos they were also bashed for it kasi, you know, they won or something. So parang I think I tweeted that. Tapos I didn't really expect it to boom.
Yeah.
And then parang sabi ko na I won because I was a Filipino and not because I'm Chinese. Kasi your surname doesn't have anything to do with what you're capable of doing. Kasi actually yung middle name ko, it's Fernandez. So naisip ko, if my name was Agatha Fernandez, would people not judge me? Would people not criticize me, diba? So parang actually it's really funny kasi in wushu I'm the only one with the Chinese surname. Lahat ng mga teammates ko there, they're parantak, inso, saklag, puro sila Filipino. Yeah. Ako lang yung may Chinese. Pero I have Filipino blood. I'm like three-fourths Filipino or one-half Filipino.
Yeah,
tapos marunong ako mag-Tagalog. Yeah. So parang, I saw no issues with that because I never grew up in China. I never grew up in the States. I grew up here. So that's what I took to Twitter. Sabi ko, I won because I'm a Filipino and I will always fight for my country. I didn't win because of my surname and because of my sport being Chinese. Yun. And everyone was really supportive. Parang
I
was really engulfed with they were really supportive and I was really touched. So,
yeah, that was when the time rin na talagang sumikat ka and people were like, magaling siya, we should give her the like recognition of being a Filipino. Kasi syempre nung ibang daming bashers na I don't know why, pero they were saying random stuff.
Yeah.
So nung sinasabi mo rin na sometimes you're okay with not being first kasi syempre parang ikaw na yung nasa top. Pero how do you remain motivated even if yun nga, back-to-back SEA Games, you're already gold. Tapos there might be SEA Games again this year and then maybe Asian Games next year. So kamusta naman yung yung mental state mo and how you remain motivated in continuing to always, you know, be on top even if you're already there at such a young age?
I think people just have to remember na every time sa sports side, regardless of if it's wushu or golf or basketball, every time we end a competitive year, so every time we end 2019, 2018, yung efforts namin, it will go back to zero. So walang guarantee na mananalo ka ulit next year or the year after that. All you have to know is that you have to keep at your potential. For example, nanalo ka ng SEA Games this noong 2019. You have to keep training to have that physical capability. Kasi hindi mo alam pagdating ng 2021 SEA Games, umasenso na yung competitor mo, tas nandun ka pa rin sa level na yun. So I think that's what also gets me going, is that I never know if someone's better than me. I just know that I have to keep going at it. You know, I always have that energy for the uncertainty. So I think that's what made me fall in love with sports in general, is because I know you never know if someone's going to be better than you. You never know if you're going to do so bad. Pero I think that's the beauty of it, yung uncertainty ng sports.
Yeah, and in playing wushu, I remember in one of your interviews, you mentioned the importance of self-discipline and hard work. So how could you explain kung gaano ka important talaga yung dalawang yun in connection to what you said then in continuing to improve and not, you know, resting on your laurels, you know?
I think I've been doing sports since I was 3 years old. So I never really weaned off of sports completely. And I'm 22 years old now. So most of my life I've been doing sports. I think yung main takeaway na nakukuha ko as an athlete who trains every day is mawawala talaga yung source of motivation mo and your inspiration. Mawawala talaga siya, kasi minsan you train for a competition that's months or even years away. For example, Olympics, diba? Like they train for it 4 or 8 years before. How are you gonna muster up your source of inspiration or motivation for that if ilang days pa bago ka magko-compete in that competition, diba? So talagang as an athlete, I think every athlete knows na you have to have discipline. Kahit na hindi athlete, kahit like in your career, your education, yeah, if you want to be the best, you cannot rely on these kinds of factors. That's very fleeting. You have every time you wake up, feeling mo ayaw mo mag-aral, pero gusto mo, you want to be in the honor roll, you have to do it kasi you know na it's good for you. So I think just training your body to have the discipline, training your mind to just, you know, kahit na ayaw mo, you have to do it. It's really a matter of values, and it's really a matter of responsibility. It's really a matter of commitment talaga. So I think for every person, one trait na they should acquire is really the discipline. Di bali na yung motivation if you don't have it. You always have to have passion and discipline, kasi motivation mawawala talaga siya over time. And when you have passion and when you have discipline, when you pair those two together, it will make a really great combination. For yes. Anything.
Yeah, you mentioned also the yung mga injuries that you endured like at every point of your life because of wushu, yeah, like with your back and your knee and all these injuries that happened. And yeah, you mentioned the passion that you need to have in this sport or your career that you want to have, and the discipline. So can you explain then the physical pain that you endure in the sport, like over the course of many years? Because baka some people think hindi naman masyadong like physical sport lang, like it's not, you don't bump people like basketball or soccer, or you don't like play boxing or something. So how can you explain it for the people that might not be aware?
I think yung best explanation for it is, since wushu isn't really a very well-known sport, I think people should try it. Kasi I've thought other people who don't know the sport, they don't have any knowledge about the sport, thus the moment they try it, they fell in love with it, they fall in love with it, thus they realize na, oh my god, it's so hard pala. So sometimes the best explanation is to try it talaga for yourself, and that's what I'm pushing for. Like I'm really trying to put wushu on the forefront of Philippine sports, kasi honestly ang hirap talaga niya. Like yung end result niya is the competition, you think na it's really easy, pero that takes years and years of hard work. Tapos, I think if I'm trying to make someone understand how hard my sport is, I would just like, wala, I would probably make them watch me train, or like I would just explain to them. Yung sa category ko, kasi every time I jump, I land on my right leg. Ganun lang siya. once you land on your right leg, yung mag-absorb ng pressure nun and nung friction nun is yung tuhod mo. So that's why I never fully recovered na from my right knee kasi that's where everything goes eh, yung jumping leg ko. Tapos parang every time I come back from a vacation or like a Christmas break sa sports, nabibigla talaga katawan ko kasi yung muscles mo, nag-weaken yung muscles natin. Every time we age, our muscles ages faster. So I feel really, really stiff. I feel like I'm in a body of a 6-year-old, honestly. Kasi I've been doing wushu for a long time. So parang nagiging mas brittle na yung bones ko, tapos I get more injured na more often. And I think for people to say na it's not that hard, well, I would understand naman kasi they don't really know much about my sport. But then again, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to promote my sport talaga and trying to make people see na even though it looks really easy, it's really hard.
Yung right knee mo na sinasabi mo that you land on a lot or like all the time, is that like is it everyone do that or is that your routine lang and your habit? Is that like a thing for
wushu? No. It's for all of the athletes in my category. So, diba tai chi chuan ako. So, every tai chi chuan athlete, they land on the right foot. Kasi yun yung required. Yeah. So, sa chang chuan and the nan chuan, they land on both legs. Pero sa tai chi, they land on one foot. Yeah, ganun siya. So, makikita mo yung may pinakamalaking legs is usually tai chi chuan. Kasi isang foot lang yung ginagamit nila. Tapos, when you land on one foot, hindi ka pwede nakastand. Kailangan you have to bend. Ganun. So, parang pistol squat. If people know that, yun.
Yeah.
So, yun yung ginagawa namin. So, it's really hard. Kasi, you know, girls, they have a slower muscle development than guys. So, you really have to work 200 times as hard just to be in the level of the guy. Yun.
And you mentioned also that you want to promote the sport here for future. Syempre, 22 ka pa, and you can teach a lot of the youth in order to love the sport. Kasi sinasabi mo nga that you taught people before and you never knew that they'd love it a lot as well. So, ano yung tingin mong future ng sport here? And maybe also internationally, because I think you mentioned na sana maging Olympic sport na rin siya in the future. So, kamusta naman yung thoughts mo with the future of the sport here and internationally?
Honestly, I think I'm at wushu is at a good pace right now in the Philippines. Regarding internationally, I think it's also making its name kasi nakakagulat kasi you would think it's a Chinese sport. Usually China is good at it, pero no, it's actually the Middle Eastern countries that's good at it. So if you see like Iran, tapos like Afghanistan, they're so good. Pero in terms of locally, I'm really proud of what I've done for the sport. Kasi that's all I can do for wushu is to give back to my sport. For like making me go through a lot of my life experiences, majority of my experiences as an athlete, I really owe it to wushu. Actually, I'm also proud because after SEA Games, I've gotten a lot of brands reaching out to me to like promote my sport. So for example, yung sa Lexus.
Yeah,
I don't know if people know this.
Yeah. I'm the Lexus.
Yeah, I'm the Lexus ambassador for one of their cars. Tapos I recently got hired by Alexander Wang for their new athletic line. So talagang I'm just really thankful because I get to do what I love and I also get to collaborate with other brands, other good brands that want to really know what my sport is. So that's the best that I can do as an athlete, as a Filipino athlete for the benefit of wushu here in the Philippines.
Yeah, with the with your like influence with the sport, syempre, and like people already know you here in the Philippines. What are your future plans with the sport? Like after the pandemic, do you plan to teach more people also, and give the youth a better like appreciation of wushu? Kasi malay mo naman gusto pala nila nga pero di lang nila alam yung sport. And or what other plans do you have?
After yung SEA Games, everyone was asking me, when are you gonna retire?
retire.
I'm only 22.
Yeah.
I'm only 22. And I think naman I can teach people, pero honestly, I think I still have a lot to learn in terms of competitive wushu. So I think I can just teach like little kids for now sa pandemic. Pero syempre, after like when I start training na again like regularly, in a gym, I don't think I can be a coach because that's what the head coach is going mm-hmm. to do. So like, I'm okay with teaching kids, but with competitive sports, I don't think I can yet because I think I still want to be part of competitive sports. So yeah.
Yeah, ano ba yun normally like retiring age? But nila niloloko na kung magre-retire ka na. Parang bata
I think
pa.
It's because I think it's because people associate it like when you win tapos na. Parang ganun. Okay. Yeah, so pero kasi for me, yung retiring age for wushu is tops like 31, 32. Pero mga 27, 28, yun na yung time usually majority of the athletes they retire in wushu. I think for me, I haven't really thought about retiring yet.
Yeah.
Because I'm only turning 23 this year. So parang medyo
bata pa.
Meron pa akong mga ibang years. Yeah. So I don't really think about retiring yet.
So kunwari nga lang like mag-retire na like kunwari like late 20s or early 30s. What are your like future plans or like your future dreams that you still plan to pursue? Kasi nga yan, medyo madami pang years that you still have even if you retire na.
I think I want to be a coach for the national team, so wushu. I think that's one of the things that I'm kind of envisioning right now. And also, since pandemic ngayon, I've thought about yun nga, branching out to furthering my education. Kasi education is really important. Like when you're doing sports, hindi ka pwede talaga mag-rely on sports alone.
Yeah.
You have to rely on also education. It's really important. Since my course is a pre-law course, I decided to take up law. I'm not sure if, you know, I'm going to push through with it. We'll see. I'm not yet sure.
Yeah.
Yun. So far, yun pa lang naman yung nakikita ko. And yeah.
Yeah. For the last portion of the interview, I usually ask like these questions also to my other guests. Like it's like a set of questions that I normally ask. So ito kasi and itong next one, it's more of focused on I'm asking it to you lang. I really haven't asked it to the others. Kasi like in the past few years, yung women in sports mas nagiging successful like abroad and even here in the Philippines. Like you know, Jamie Lim also won gold and you and Sila Pauline Lopez. So what do you think about like the gender equality here in the Philippines and also abroad about sports? Like for example, also sa WNBA, like now they're so vocal na about the inequality of the NBA and the WNBA and ganun. You know, so how do you think like the progress of women fighting for equality in sports?
I think internationally as a whole, as like the whole world, we're so slow at the at the development between the two genders. That is to say between the male and the females, ha. Like it's sobrang slow natin kasi like it's been like more than a decade. Tapos like ngayon lang natin na realize yung parang women should be paid like equal to men kasi you know we can do the same things.
Yeah.
With sports kasi it's really hard, especially kasi Philippines it's a male dominated society, it's a patriarchal society, because we have certain cultures that really associate men more than women. So I think right now I'm really at awe like with myself and with my other fellow Filipina athletes kasi they're really paving the way for Filipinas in sports. They're really vocalizing na girls can do sports too and they can also develop and they can also improve and they can also be the best. Like for example, si Heidelin Diaz, right?
Si Jamie. Si
Yeah, they're so good. Like Jamie graduated with like top honors at UP and then she also went on to winning SEA Games. Like these are the things that women are capable of. So why do we think that men can only do them? Like it's really time for us to take more speedy initiatives towards this movement because it's really important, especially for the future generation that we will be with in a few years.
Oh, yeah, I really appreciate it also. Like, lalo na ngayon nakikita ko with the people, like they're more vocal now. Kasi tama naman yung sinasabi nila eh. So, syempre, parang di kanyo matatakot and you're just having like the conscious effort, I guess. And you know, yung mas knowledgeable ka na rin with the inequality and you're able to voice your opinion. So, makapakinggan ka, malay mo naman, diba? And then, maging equal na nga for sana all sports eventually.
Yeah, sana all.
Yeah. So, for the next question, ito yung the one I asked my other guests also. It's about yung social issues and political issues. Kasi like, I don't know if you know, sa NBA, nung nasa bubble sila, it was like before the elections, the players were vocal about the Black Lives Matter and the teaching them how to vote for elections. And yeah, you mentioned also that you and Jamie want to help for the elections also, like in 2022. And what do you think about athletes being vocal about social issues and political issues? Kasi syempre, like may platform kayo na followers na baka sundin kayo ng mga tao. Kunwari like may issue, tapos nag-tweet kayo, tapos they'll say, ah, ganun pala yun, hindi ko alam yun na. So, parang they'll regret what they said. Pero you guys help them, like, you gain knowledge or you enhance their knowledge with the issue. So what's your thoughts on that? And do you think athletes can affect the, you know, the country with those issues?
I think we're one of the groups, we're part of the group of people that really are at an kind of an advantage because we have this influence, especially if you're a really well-known athlete. So parang if you have the right values and you have the just values, I think it's really important to promote yung right mo to vote. Kasi, syempre, we're not only athletes, kasi we're also residents here in the Philippines, we're also Filipinos. So parang just exercising your right to vote is really vital kasi that means you're doing your part for the society and also for the whole of the Philippines. Hindi lang ikaw yung magbe-benefit, like it's also your fellow Filipinos. So I think it's a really good movement actually. And also syempre, be responsible about your choices and also know who you are voting for. Yun lang.
Yeah, I like also athletes speaking out, like you tell the people like what you know ganyan. Kasi sabi rin ng ibang athletes na nahihirapan sila sa tingin nila yung ibang athletes na nahihirapan because Filipinos are naturally like mahihiyain or they don't want to like share what they know, but it's maybe the culture and the upbringing. Pero kasi kunwari sa US, yung example na binigay ko, mas vocal sila doon and they say they're very frank with what they think about and what they know. Kaya siguro nakaka-affect.
Yes, actually there are more Filipinos na, not only athletes, who are really stepping up their game. They're really becoming more vocal and I'm really happy to see that.
Yeah, sana talaga tuloy-tuloy.
Yeah.
So ito, for fun lang na question, it's from a podcast sa America. It's from a basketball podcast. They ask their guests, like towards the end, if you had the opportunity to have 5 guests and you have dinner with them, like a formal dinner, who would you choose? It's from like across any like industry, anywhere. 5 dinner guests, dead or alive, who would you choose?
Okay. See Ruth Ginsburg.
Who's that? Sorry.
You know her, right? No. Oh, really? Oh, she's in the US. Like she's one of the lawyers for the, I think, Supreme Court. Parang ganun. Oh, okay. She's a justice, I think. Yeah.
Ah, okay.
See Ruth Gator Ginsburg. Tapos si Audrey Hepburn. Because I really look up to her, si Audrey Hepburn. And then, well, sin pa ba? Michelle Obama.
Ah, okay.
Michelle Obama. Tapos, who else? Wait. I'm not sure. I also want to have dinner with the female scientist who developed the COVID vaccine. I just forgot. Scientist.
I don't know.
Kasi mag-asawa sila. So I would want the both of them kasi they're really, really good at what they do. And talagang they really paved the way for the vaccine talaga. Like, sobrang galing. Yeah. So yun, those are the 5 people.
Ah, okay. So for the final question, I also asked my guests this. If I'm asking you on who should I guest here on the DVD show, like any sport, it could be like, yeah, they have a good story or they're maganda makipagkwentuhan with them. Who could you suggest na pwede kong i-guest? And yeah.
I think, sino ba yung pwede? I think sa taekwondo. Like yung ano yung Pumsay team ng men and women kasi they're really really good. Tapos I'm really surprised kasi they don't get that much exposure. So I would want them to really be exposed kasi they're really good at what they do. Tapos they've been long time friends of mine and they're just really down to earth and you would really want to, you know, be with them.
Yeah, that's pretty cool because personally I'm not that familiar with them. As you mentioned, they don't
yeah.
get as much exposure.
Yeah, they were the first and second team event that won bronze at Asian Games before me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so the men's Pumsay and then the women's Pumsay.
Ah, okay. So yeah, hindi lang nabibigyan siguro ng exposure pero magaling talaga din sila. Yeah.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, so I want to thank you again so much, Agatha, for joining me here on the DVD show. And thank you so much for giving me some of your time and sharing your story for the viewers to learn something and, you know, baka magamit din nila sa sarili nilang careers and profession. So do you have any final words before you go?
I'd just like to thank you for giving me this opportunity again. Mm-hmm. And also I had a lot of fun. This kind of podcast really just gave me a break because I've been studying all day. So thank you talaga for, you know, for giving me time to talk about myself and also talk about my passion and my advocacy.
Yeah, so before you go, is it okay if we take a picture?
Sure.
Ah, okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay, again, thank you so much again, Agatha, for joining me. And yeah, stay safe.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Bye.